Started recording.
Very good. Thank you so much. What is your name?
Diyali sir.
Diyali, very good. Thank you so much. So, dear students, you are welcome in this class. And today we will see the brief history of organic agriculture. So, what happened in the Europe and America? We got industrial revolution. Industrial revolution during 1760 and 1840. Before that, all agriculture in Europe, America, or developed economy, it was all organic. And in India, before Green Revolution came in 1960s. All our agriculture was mostly this organic agriculture before 1960. But in Europe, before 1760 to 1840, it was all organic agriculture. But during 1760 to 1840, they got industrial revolution. A lot of technological developments happened. In India, after or during Green Revolution, we know that hybrid, hybridling varieties and of wheat and rice were introduced, and we increased area under irrigation, fertilizer increase, fertilizer consumption, and then pesticide use. Similarly, in Europe, they had one industrial development in respect of textile, steam power, iron making, invention of machines, tools, glass making. All the modern industries were established during those periods. And not only this, many industrial products were related to agriculture, like machines for agriculture were prepared for harvesting, for spraying, for transport, lot of pesticides, fertilizers, all sorts of modern inputs were developed in Europe and America. So you can see during those times, Jethro Tull, he invented a horse-drawn hoeing machine or hoe and a seed drill with tines to sow the row crops. By middle of the 19th century, single super phosphate was made in England, mainly by Lewis made the single super phosphate. He got some patent. The first tractor in this internal combustion engine was made by USA in 1910. And before that, mostly they used external combustion engines for drawing coal from the coal mines or wherever they needed lift or wherever they needed power, they used external combustion engine. Haber and Bosch, they made ammonia artificially, they synthesized for commercial production of ammonia. That means you can make fertilizers easily. So fertilizer production increased due to ammonia synthesis. And similarly, DDT was synthesized by Muller in 1939 in Switzerland. And BSC was discovered in France. And nitrophenols are the kind of herbicide. They were also developed. So during all those times of industrial revolution and subsequently, a lot of chemicals and pesticide and machines were developed for agriculture. And then they were definitely, what for they were made? They were made to be used in agriculture. And they started using it. And suddenly the agriculture in USA and England and some other countries, France, it got chemicalized. It got increased use of chemicals and fertilizers. And at the same time, during the same period almost, you see Justus von Liebig was there, and he developed the law of minimum, and he believed that mineral salts were the only nutrients plant needed, and they would completely replace manure. Kind of mineral theory of nutrition was developed by Justus Liebig. And he also encouraged the use of fertilizers. So, and also proposed the law of minimum. What happened, the consequences of chemical farming in Europe and America were very early realized by the people there. Not just people, consumer and all people got aware about the harms chemicals were doing to the environment, to the soil health and also to the water or human health. So they started realizing. By that time, India was still organic, almost organic, up to 1960. But in early 1905, 1910, those people realized that we have gone a wrong way. So they started comparing Indian agriculture or agriculture in China or agriculture in East to the agriculture of West at that time. So F.H. King, he was from USA, a scientist. Farmers of 40th century or permanent agriculture in China, Korea, and Japan. So he actually traveled to the Eastern world, and he wrote his experiences, and he explained that how this conventional agriculture or whatever farmers are doing without chemicals and pesticides, that is sustainable. That is a good agriculture. So he just traveled and wrote his experiences in this book. It is called as Travelogue. Travelogue means experiences during travel. If you write your experiences, that is called as travelogue. Now, sometimes back, you got Rudolf Steiner in Germany. He gave biological or this, what was the name of his agriculture? Biodynamic agriculture. He gave the concept of biodynamic agriculture, and he gave some lectures, and those lectures were compiled by his disciples. And he was founder of Anthroposophy and father of biodynamic agriculture. So in 1928, Demeter, the organization, formed around Steiner's teachings. So he taught people, creating the set of standards to define sustainable agricultural practices. We definitely need not to go into the much detail of biodynamic agriculture. Actually, there are more than at least 30 variants of organic agriculture. Organic agriculture has so many variants that are difficult to explain. So sometimes in another lecture, I will tell you what kind of variants are there, variants of organic agriculture, which kind of agriculture should be called organic. We will discuss that in detail. But for the time being, you just remember that Rudolf Steiner was proponent of organic farming, and kind of organic farming he promoted was biodynamic agriculture. Now, in 1939, Lord Northumberland from USA, America, he wrote a book, Look to the Land. Look to the Land, and this was a good book, and the farm itself must have a biological completeness. So he said that everything should be prepared on the farm. You need not to bring the things from outside. And also it is a living entity. He given emphasis on soil biology, actually. He given much emphasis. And it must be a unit which has within itself a balanced organic life. So he gave very good views in this book, Look to Land, and it promoted organic farming. So if somebody asks you that who was the person who gave the term organic farming first time, answer is Lord Northumberland, USA, in 1939. Now, another person, she was Lady Eve Balfour from United Kingdom. She also made very good contribution. She wrote a book, and she has done some experimentation also. And the name of the book was The Living Soil. So it was written in 1943 and spreading the organic philosophy globally. So see, during that time, we were already organic. India was organic, but they were worried. People in the West were worried in 1943. So her book inspired the founding of the Soil Association in Britain in 1946, which is now modernized, and it has got some slightly different name, I think. So she said that there is close relationship between soil fertility and human health. And decline in soil humus or fertility or soil health result in decline in human health. So almost similar ideas were given by many other people, like Lord McCarrison and Albert Hobart. They also gave the same opinion, of course, maybe in different years, but they gave some same opinion that health of the soil is directly linked to health of the plant and finally health of the animals and human beings. In 1947, after that, doctors and consumers blame agricultural chemicals for causing the development of cancer and mental disorders. So these kind of reports came from the people that these kind of products of farming is not good for people's health, and it is causing some diseases in human beings. So it came in 1947. And J.I. Rodell from USA, basically he was a having a publisher. He was a publisher. He used to publish several dictionaries or books and so on. So, but he found some interest in organic agriculture. So he started a magazine, Organic Farming and Gardening, in 1942. And the contribution were made by Mr. or Dr. Albert Howard. He used to contribute some articles to this magazine, Organic Farming and Gardening. He authored many books and published, and he also demonstrated organic farming and gardening techniques on his research farm. So he developed a small research farm also, where he has demonstrated some technologies related to organic farming. And he was, of course, founder of the Rodell Press. He popularized the concept in the USA, concept of organic farming. And he wrote a book, which was The Healthy Hunjas, 1942. Rodell Press published it, 255 pages. So Hunjas are the tribal people living in Pakistan. I will discuss, and they have very long life. Their average life is more than 100 years. So those people were the subject of studies. Many people studied that why these Hunja people live long. What is the reason behind their so long life? So we'll discuss later. In 1947, Rodell established the Soil and Health Foundation, which is now called as the Rodell Institute. At present, this Rodell Institute is working in USA. It is very active. They are doing research and popularization of organic farming in USA. If you type Rodell Institute, you will get the details. And those who are interested to go into the more details, want to know more what is happening in USA or Rodell Institute, you can go there. Now see, this is the website of Rodell Institute. You can explore the website and see what they are doing in USA. Now come back to the East, to the Japan. Japanese farmer, I think you know, M. Fukuoka from Japan. So he was fundamentally a farmer and philosopher, and he has written a book, The One Straw Revolution, an Introduction to Natural Farming. So where he has given his concept of natural farming. So many times people get confused in natural farming, ecological farming, organic farming. So I will try to explain the differences in all these. When we discuss, maybe in the next or next to next lecture, I will clarify those things. So for the time being, just you may consider that natural farming is different from organic farming, what we are doing. Natural farming may be considered as organic farming, and all variants of organic farming are not or natural farming. So just for the time being, you remember this. The natural way of farming, the theory and practice of green philosophy. So he has written both these books in Japanese language, and later on they were translated into English and maybe to some other languages. So English version came in 1978 and for the first book, and 1985 for the second book. So you can see the dates, and he emphasized that you need not to go for tillage, no till, no herbicide, nothing. Just you broadcast the seed and go for harvesting. Don't do anything, kind of nothing do farming. So if you have interest, the books are available. Books from this Fukuoka are available. If you are interested to know what kind of practices were recommended by Fukuoka, I have a copy of the book. Whatever books I am showing you, I have copies of all the books. Anybody interested can send me mail, I will share. Then Rachel Carson, she got very good name, and she has written a book, Silent Spring, by Rachel Carson. So the name of the book was Silent Spring, 1962. And she was basically a biologist, marine biologist, author and conservationist. And she opened the world's eyes to the damage done by the pesticide. What kind of damages are being done by pesticide to the environments? She exposed this kind of information through her book. And then Hans Müller and Mary Müller, they were husband and wife from Switzerland, and they were proponents of organic biological agriculture. And they worked through 1950s. So this is also kind of variant of organic farming, organic biological agriculture. And they worked closely with Hans Peter Rösch. Actually, Hans Peter Rösch was their teacher who developed a natural and sustainable approach to farming. They named it organic biological agriculture. So they were follower of Peter Rösch, Hans Peter Rösch. And see the Hans Peter Rösch from Germany. He wrote two books in German. You can read the German name, I cannot. So you see these German names of this book. And he gave the concept of nature as a cycle of living particles, built the theoretical background of organic biological agriculture. So for the time being, you can just remember that they were related to organic biological agriculture. So it is organic agriculture. They have added one more word, organic biological agriculture, giving more thrust to certain living particles. Means they may be living organism, they may be nematodes, they may be viruses, they may be bacteria, whatever it is. So you need not to go into the much details of these, because now people are not bothered about these. This is just history and they are not being followed, except the biodynamic agriculture. In some cases, this biodynamic agriculture is being followed by people. So now we go to modern science or modern concern, modern organization. It is also part of history. International Federation of Organic Agriculture Movements. Basically, it was established first time in Versailles, France in 1972. Later on, it was moved to Bonn, Germany. So right now it is in Germany, but it was in the beginning established in France. Provides authoritative information about organic agriculture, promote worldwide and exchange knowledge. So actually this IFOM is not a governmental organization. It is a private organization. Some industries or some people who have interest in promotion of organic farming, they have come together and they have formed this internationally umbrella organization. The rules, regulations, guidelines of IFOM are not binding on the government, but they are kind of suggestive. They give you suggestions, they give you ideas, and they promote organic farming. And every 3 years, they are organizing Organic World Congress. Organic World Congress. Recently, it was organized in 2017 in India. In Greater Noida, it was organized. And this year is 2021. But last year they could not organize it. And this year it is being organized in the month of October. October 2021, they are organizing this International Agronomy Congress in France. It is in France, I think France or Germany, I will confirm you. So provides authoritative information about organic agriculture, promote worldwide and exchange the knowledge. So then after IFOM, you got Meadows et al. And co-workers, Club of Rome, Italy, now in Switzerland. This Club of Rome, it is now in Switzerland. So they wrote a book, The Limits of Growth, by Meadow and so on. So The Limits of Growth in 1972, and they discussed the issue of growth of human population and global economy. And several questions were raised by them. What will happen if the growth in the world's population continues unchecked? What will be the environmental consequences if economic growth continues at its current pace? So they also gave some ideas related to control of population and kind of food or availability of the food if we increase the population. Then E.F. Schumacher is German person, and he wrote a book, Small is Beautiful, Economics as if People Mattered. So this book also got picture of Mahatma Gandhi. You can see on the first page, cover page of this book, you see Mahatma Gandhi's picture was there. So this was influenced by thoughts or ideology of Mahatma Gandhi. So this book was authored, This Small is Beautiful, A Study of Economics as If People Mattered, 1973. He wrote many radical ideas in the above book, including the concept of sacrificing economic growth for a more fulfilling working life and making quality of life the central goal of economics. Means he criticized the industrial development that in the name of growth, in the name of development, you are creating pollution. You are, because these industrial industries, they will create air, soil, water, food pollution, all kind of pollution. So we don't want that pace of industrial development. Let us have some minimum level of industries so that quality of human life is not compromised. So he talked of economics, food, industries, and so on. And then in 1970s, there was some movement in Europe, Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food. So it was mostly in developed countries, USA, Canada, Australia, Europe. So they said that, this movement said that, encourage the consumption of locally grown food. There is the promotion of this concept with slogans such as Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food. So they started, and this was practically the promotion of organic agriculture. Because if you know the local farmer, and you can easily know that what kind of inputs they are using. So this encouraged organic agriculture. 1980s, groups pressure for government regulation of organic production. So several groups made some pressures on the government. It is not in our country, but in many developed countries, people are very much bothered or worried about the climate. Of course, climate and this quality of the food or environment. Of course, they are the polluter of the environment. But at the same time, there is slogans, there is their voice against these kind of pollutions. You see America, America, France, or any developed country, they are the largest polluters of the environment. But at the same time, they show a lot of concern about the environment. So I don't know means how to make a compromise, who is right, who is wrong. But overall, we need to assess their things. Maybe they are using some pesticides or fertilizer or chemicals under certain control. And pollution is mostly by the industries. Now in 1989, Cuba institutes urban food production called Organoponicos. Maybe their language. Which language is spoken in Cuba? Anybody, is it English, Portuguese, Spanish, French? What kind of language is there in Cuba? Anybody can tell? Can anybody tell? I don't know. That is
Spanish,
why I'm...
Spanish.
Yes, okay.
Sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So Cuba started some form of organic agriculture. Some encouragement was there for organic agriculture in 1989. And in 1990s, retail market for organic farming started growing. So the retail market for organic farming in developed economies is growing about 20%. So in 90s, people started using organic products. And what were the drivers? Why people started using organic products? Quality and safety of food. This was number one criterion. Why people wanted to have organic food? Because of better quality and safety. Safety here means that they do not contain heavy metals, pollutants, toxic material, or any unwanted thing is not there in the food. Quality means they are nutritionally rich. So because of these two reasons, people started using organic food. And other was the potential for environmental damage. The secondary or next issue was, okay, we will eat the organic food so that we can take care of the environment, or we can help in the protection of the environment over the conventional like that. 1991, European Union provides a legal framework. Now some legal framework came from the governments, particularly European Union. So 2002, United States adopts the National Organic Program. This is known as NOP, National Organic Program. The United States provided a development framework for organic agriculture. So this was the intervention from the government of United States of America. So this was history related to overall very brief history of world organic agriculture. Now see what happened in India during this period. So are you awakened or are you sleeping?
No, sir.
You are active. Very good. So now just in 5 minutes or 10 minutes, I will explain history in India about organic agriculture. As I told you that our agriculture became chemical, or chemical farming started after or during the time of Green Revolution. Before that, it was all organic. So what happened, European and American people, they have a lot of interest in Indian agriculture. They have interest in agriculture of China, Korea, Japan, because those were mostly organic agriculture. And by that time, people got so many issues in developed countries related to chemical farming or conventional agriculture. And then they started looking towards the East. So they traveled to East and they wanted to get knowledge and experience from the East. Also, by that time, India was already a colony of British people. And so many Britishers were there in India. And they were in the lead. They were head of the departments. They were on the top position. They were governors. They were officers and everything. So similarly, in the scientific world, most of the departments, government departments, were headed by English people. Even this division of agronomy, it was headed by some white. Dr. White was the first head of the department of agronomy. Similarly, there may be some head of the department in soil science. They got Phipps lab. So it all started from 1905. Or much before that, that was Agriculture Research Station in Bihar, Samastipur, where this Howard was posted as a botanist. He was sent as a botany man to breed wheat varieties. His job was to develop varieties of the wheat. He worked there in 1905 to 1924. Organic agriculture begins in Central Europe and India simultaneously during this period. So he came to that place much before 1905, along with his wife and sister. There were three people, and he is considered as father of modern organic agriculture. He worked at Pusa, Bengal. That time it was Bihar and Bengal were one state, so it is mentioned Bengal, but at this moment, this place is in Bihar. So he documented traditional Indian farming practices and came to regard them as superior to conventional agriculture. So actually he learned agriculture from our farmer, our people, and he took those ideas back to the Europe and America, that Indian agriculture or farmers are doing wonderful agriculture, food is good, this and that. So he was proponent of organic agriculture and against the chemical farming of Europe and America. He was first book to include organic agriculture in his title. So actually he written two important books. One was An Agricultural Testament. So it is worth reading for all of you. An Agricultural Testament, you must read this book. How the concept of agriculture or soil fertility, soil health started. Now you have very advanced knowledge of soil quality, soil fertility. But if you want to learn ABCD, you must read this book. It is written in very simple and very common language. Very interesting book. And at that time, he described the role of mycorrhiza. We are talking these days that mycorrhiza is playing a lot of role, this and that. But in 1940s, he was knowing the role of mycorrhiza, and he explained in this book about mycorrhiza. So second book came in 1947, The Soil and Health, A Study of Organic Agriculture. So first time this organic agriculture word came in the title of a book, which is written by him. This is the book, Soil Health a Study of Organic Agriculture. This is the cover page. I have copies of both the books. I can share. So he worked also in, after he left this Bihar after some time, and he requested the princely state of Indore to get some land. So the king or the prince, whatsoever was there, he has given some land to him. Okay, you can do your research work in Indore. So because he had interest in organic agriculture, so you know, to sustain the fertility, you need some manure. To produce the manure, you need some organic material. And then those organic materials should be composted. So to supply nutrient, you need a composting process. So he developed composting process, which is known as Indore composting process, developed by Hobart in 1933 and 1935. And this is actually aerobic composting process. Bangalore process is there, which was given by C.N. Acharya, that is anaerobic composting process. Here it is aerobic composting process. So North American as well as British organic farming was fundamentally influenced by Hobart. He was studying here, he was doing work here, and then writing papers and newspapers and articles for European countries and America. So he was influencing agriculture there. So they were converting to organic again. So by integrating the different agricultural research disciplines, he concluded that the health of soil, plants, animals, and humans are interrelated. A humus-rich soil is the key for successful. So he has given a lot of emphasis on humus. Increase the humus material in your soil, you can sustain your fertility, you can get good production. And that time in Indore, he also made studies on the root. What happens to the root if you apply humus or organic matter in the soil? So he studied interaction of soil with the humus and vis-a-vis root growth. Albert Hobart, there was one more Britisher who was known as Lord MacCarrison or Sir Robert MacCarrison. So he was basically an army person. He was officer, army officer or doctor. I can say he was a doctor in British Army, or maybe that time they were calling Indian Army, whatever you call, but he was a doctor for army in India. And he founded Institute of Nutrition in 1918, some place in Tamil Nadu. It was established, the Institute of Nutrition. So originally a single room laboratory at the Pasteur Institute, Kunur. So Kunur is a place in Tamil Nadu. There in one room, he started a small laboratory, which is he named as Institute of Nutrition. And he was assigned the duty to study the beriberi, and a beriberi was quite common, a quite damaging disease. People were not knowing the reasons or cure of that disease. So he made a unit of beriberi inquiry unit there. The facility moved to Hyderabad in 1958, and in 1969, it was renamed the National Institute of Nutrition. So right now, this is a very advanced institute located in Hyderabad, which is known as NIN, National Institute of Nutrition. Those have interest in this institute can see they are doing research on food items. So you can see the website. It is a government organization, Government of India organization, NIN. So what he did studies on Hunza tribes, he did studies on rats, he did studies on Indian diets, he did studies on organic diets and so on. So that is why he is part of Indian history, because he worked in India, as your Albert Hobart also worked in India. So Robert MacCarrison, Nutrition Research Lab in Kunur, and what he did, he studied the relationship among soil fertility, food quality, and human nutrition. And he was a person who said that decrease food quality due to increased use of mineral nitrogen fertilizer. If you put more fertilizer in soil, it reduces the food quality. He said like this, and he did publish some papers. So he also studied the health and physique of the Hunza tribe men. And this is one study he made, diet and physique of Indian races. So he has taken different races of India. Hunza hillmen from that time, Pakistan was part of India. East Coast cultivator, maybe from Odisha or some part. And then one Bengali diet and one Tibet hillmen and Nepalese hillmen and one Madrasi diet. He has taken from all corners of India. He has taken some diet, some kind of food. Suppose Punjab food or Punjabi food, Sikh food, Marathi food, Pathan food, and so many food. He has compared on rats. He has taken those constituents which were used by human beings. He has tested these different diets, which he named based upon a particular group of people. And then he found that Sikh diet was the best. Sikh diet was the best. And you can see he has also studied organic diet. And he said that Hunza hillmen overall was the most best diet. Whole cereal grains were eaten by Hunza tribes, mainly wheat, milk, vegetables, and abundant fruits, apricots, and meat occasionally. So you can go through it. It is all part of history. So you can see the rat. You can. He also compared the Sikh diet with the European diet. So first he has surveyed Indian diets and he found Sikh diet is the best. And then he compared the best diet with the European diet. And he got some conclusion. And you can go through this. And ultimately, I think he found that Sikh diet was even better than the European diets. So you can go through such kind. Now we go to Hunza tribes, Hunza people. So these people are indigenous to the Hunza Valley. In the Karakoram Mountains, I think you know about Karakoram Range. It passes through Pakistan. Mountains of northern Pakistan in the Gilgit-Baltistan region of Pakistan. So one region, one independent area, partly independent, it is under control of Pakistan, Gilgit-Baltistan region of Pakistan. The Hunza is situated northwest of the Hunza River. So actually name of the valley is Hunza Valley. And one river is passing through that river, which is also a Hunza river. And people living in Hunza are also Hunza people. So this Hunza name is quite common. It may have come from Hunza river or Hunza hill or Hunza people, I don't know. But this Hunza prefix is used. So now you can see the location of this red color, the picture. Red color, it is shown in the map. When the Kashmir ends, and then you can see this red color area. So this is actually a Hunza Valley, indigenous to Hunza Valley in the Karakoram Mountains of northern Pakistan, in the Gilgit-Baltistan region of Pakistan. The Hunza is situated northwest of the Hunza River. And as I told you before, that J.I. Rodel also studied Hunza. Lord McCarrison also studied Hunzas. And this Rodel has already written a book, The Healthy Hunzas, in 1955. And Hunzas noted for their longevity. What is the reason? Because they are eating organic foods. They have plenty of fresh air. Actually, Pakistan has disturbed their peace. Otherwise, they were very peace-loving people, very nice people. There are no tractor, there are no pollution. It is pollution-free area, still pollution-free area. Modern amenities of development have not reached there. And this you can see on the left side, Hunza Valley. Many people claim that Hunza Valley is more beautiful, much more beautiful than the Kashmir Valley. So many foreigners, many tourists visit Hunza Valley. Even Pakistanis, they have a craze to visit this Hunza Valley. Few months back, this government of Pakistan has, or not, maybe 1 year back, they had some elections there, they wanted to impose their rule. Of course, Pakistani rule is there. Maybe it is not treated as a state, independent state. And some people say that when Alexander the Great, Sikandar, you might be knowing, Alexander the Great, when he was returning back to his country, to Greece, that time certain soldiers, some soldiers stayed in that area, Gilgit-Baltistan region. They found good fruits, apricot, badam, all sorts of fruits were there. Dry fruits are very common there. They grow like weeds. These apricots or skobani or akhrot, this English name I don't know, almonds, etc. So those people are eating a lot of dry fruits, fresh air, and they live over 100 years. So you can see their color of these people is, color of eyes is green. They are not looking Pakistani or Indian. So did you know that Hunza Valley, a small and remote mountainous place in Pakistan, is home to some of the healthiest people on the earth? They are the healthiest people on the earth. They live well past 100 and have almost no reports of cancer. Their secret, consuming apricot seeds, which contain vitamin B17, that has been shown to decrease the risk of various forms of cancers. They consume approximately 200 times more vitamin B17 than the average American. I don't know. I knew about B12, vitamin B12. Now one more vitamin is added to my dictionary. B17, do you agree to it? Do we have vitamin B17? I don't know. Anybody can add some ideas add to this point? Do we really have this vitamin B17? I have not heard. Is it typing mistake or genuinely we have vitamin B17? Are you active there?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So do you have any idea? If you have, kindly share. If you don't have, no problem. You can check from your mobile. Do we really have? I did not pay much attention, but now I have seen B17. I'm not saying it is not there, and I'm not saying it is there. I need to check it. But what is your view about vitamin B17? Okay, I will check it. Now, in the modern time, the government of, just 10-15 minutes more, there were certain initiatives taken. It is also part of history, modern history. In India, what has been done? So launching of National Program of Organic Production, NPOP, in 2000, this program was launched and it was implemented in 2001. The accreditation and certification program started on 1st October 2001. So you need to remember NPOP, National Program of Organic Production. It is implemented by APEDA, A-P-E-D-A. APEDA is an agency under Ministry of Commerce. So the job of NPOP, which was started in 2001, is to promote, protect, and develop the Indian organic movement. Remember, it is to promote, protect, and develop the Indian organic movement. Install accreditation and certification processes. Accreditation, I will tell you what is meant by accreditation later, and certification also. So on 26 July 2002, organic logo was released by Government of India. So you can remember the years, the launching of NPOP in 2000, the accreditation and certification program started in 2001, and organic logo, India organic logo, was launched in 2002. You need not to remember the dates, but at some places you will find these years are asked in your quiz exams. Now, the Ministry of Commerce implements NPOP through APEDA. So APEDA is a part of Ministry of Commerce, which implements NPOP. So what this government is doing, what this APEDA is doing under NPOP? So they have developed national organic standards. Standards are the do's and don'ts of organic production. or processing or transport or marketing. So national standards were developed by India in 2005 and they were revised in 2014. So now revised organic standards are available with EPIDA. The other job is accreditation criteria for accrediting inspection and certification agency. Accreditation means just authorization, authorizing a particular agency to start certification. And there must be certain criteria so that a particular company or particular group of people can be authorized to do the certification. You need to lay down certain criteria based upon which you will select, you will approve that this particular company can do certification. This is known as accreditation criteria. Brief this history, organic schemes of government, organic farming were launched by Government of India. Some directly deal with organic farming and some indirectly. So National Project on Organic Farming was started by Government of India and National Horticulture Mission. So some job of organic farming is done in NHM. Horticulture Mission for Northeast and Himalayan State also support organic farming. National Project on Management of Soil Health and Fertility, it also supports organic farming, and Network Project on Organic Farming. This is located in Indian Institute of Farming System Research, IIFSR, Modipuram. This Network Project on Organic Farming, it is a multi-institutional project. It started in 2004 in Meerut. So here, there are about 18 to 20 centers under this project. And of course, the PKVY, Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. Sometimes full form of PKVY is asked. So sometimes a student mistake, in place of P, they write Prime Minister Krishi Vikas Yojana. So it is not Prime Minister Krishi Vikas Yojana, it is Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. So actually, according to this Yojana, they consider organic agriculture as paramparagat, means conventional farming. If I ask you, you are in PhD student, if I ask you, what do you mean by conventional farming? So you will definitely say it is our chemical farming, or modern farming is now conventional farming. But according to this scheme, this organic farming is conventional farming, and other kind of farming is not conventional. It was not our convention. It is your different kind of farming, chemical farming. So here, paramparagat farming means your, paramparagat krishi means your organic farming. So a subcomponent of soil health management scheme under National Mission of Sustainable Agriculture, NMSA, it aims to develop development of sustainable models of organic farming through a mix of traditional wisdom. So this PKVY, if you want to know in detail, you can go to Ministry of Agriculture website. You can find a lot of details about this scheme. So government is supporting or promoting organic farming under this scheme. They are giving subsidy to the farmer and they are helping the farmers in the process of certification. So it is this scheme is facilitating promotion of organic farming in the country. And how it is done, they are, for example, 50 or more farmers can form a cluster. The other objective of Government of India through this scheme is to increase the area under organic farming. So in this case, 50 or more farmers can come together in adjacent areas, adjacent land, and they can make total 50 acres of land. And they will be provided some subsidy and support by the government. Around 20,000 rupees per acre will be given to the farmers, and it will be about rupees 50,000 per hectare. So this kind of subsidy is being given by government. And another part of history is 18 January 2016, where Prime Minister of India declared Sikkim as the India's first organic state. So 18 January, you need not to remember, but you can remember 2016, January 2016, Sikkim was declared as organic state, fully organic state. And the area is small. Area of the agricultural area where organic farming is done, or farming or agriculture is done in Sikkim is nearly 75,000 hectares. This is the total area under organic agriculture or agriculture in Sikkim. But maybe a small area, but some beginning has been made. And many states are in pipeline, like Uttarakhand. There was some news some 2 years back. I've seen that they are moving towards the organic farming. They wanted to ban the chemical fertilizer in certain blocks, districts, and they are moving forward. And there are some training opportunities in organic farming, and organic leadership course is offered by IFOM. And National Center of Organic Farming, Ghaziabad, NCOF, they are also offering 1 month diploma in organic agriculture to agricultural graduates or postgraduate or maybe just 12th pass, higher secondary pass people. They can do 1 month diploma. It is free of charge. They are providing free lodging and boarding. And also, if you go across the world, across India, you'll find some seminars, some symposia, some talks, some discussion. And this 19th Organic World Congress was organized in Delhi. Actually, it was in Greater Noida or Noida. So you can name it New Delhi. Instead of Noida, you can name. And international agencies, IFOM, I have told, it was established in 1972. And there are certain European agencies are there at Europe level. And Australia also have their program. Australia has got highest area under organic agriculture. About 13 million hectare area of Australia is under organic agriculture. Organic agriculture, and FIBL is organization from Switzerland. It promotes, supports organic farming. They collect a lot of data, and one publication is there, World of Organic Agriculture. Every year they are collecting world data on organic agriculture. They are publishing in the form of a book, World of Organic Agriculture. USA also have their own standards. In Asia, every country now has their own standard, own system of organic organic farming regulation. Thailand, every country, even small country, Mauritius. Mauritius has declared that we want to be whole area of our country should be organic by so many years. And countries like Maldives, so many countries there, they are moving towards organic farming. Just they are looking for tourism opportunities in the name of organic farming. So of course there are many national agencies like APIDA, NCOF, I told you, ICR has started one institute, NOFRI, NOFRI, National Organic Farming Research Institute. Maybe 2-3 years back, ICR started this institute, independent institute, working on organic farming research in Sikkim. And ICR network project on organic farming, I have told you, it is in Modipuram. And some state agricultural university are also doing research, teaching, and extension on organic farming. So full form of APIDA, you can remember, Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority. And PG Diploma, IGNU is your Indira Gandhi National Open University. They are offering PG Diploma in Organic Agriculture. So it is their kind of certificate, and people can get training in organic farming. And HPKV Palampur already have MSc Organic Agriculture Department. And MIT Universities also have a School of Organic Agriculture. They are giving degrees in MSc Organic Agriculture. NCERT has published at least 2 books on organic agriculture. And they have made 6th, 7th, and 8th standard, they need to study organic agriculture as a chapter. Now chapters are there in NCERT book on organic agriculture. So in European countries, America, it is already there. Some degrees are there for MSc and PhD in organic agriculture. And PAU recently, just 2-3 years back, this Punjab Agricultural University, which was a staunch supporter of chemical farming, now they have switched over. They are coming back to organic farming. So PAU established a center, new school of organic farming. And just sometimes back recently, this ICR has approved MSc in organic agriculture. So you can see a national core group has been constituted long back in 2017. and they gave their recommendations. And in agriculture, now there are 19 broad subject matter, BSMA. BSMA is broad subject matter area, like plant production, crop improvement, your natural resources, physical science, social science. So likewise, there are about 19 broader area. Some belong to animal sciences. So among these 19, one is your physical sciences, and our natural resources come in physical sciences, agriculture, meteorology, agronomy, soil science, agriculture, physics, and of course, organic farming. So in MSc, and now you can see MSc has been started. Now many university, many SAU will be free to start MSc in organic farming. However, PhD is not there. That is the part of the story. But definitely, if a beginning has been made, maybe in coming 8-10 years, definitely India may have PhD in organic farming also. But at the same time, there is a bad news for environmental science. This discipline is not listed in any of the sub-disciplines. There are many sub-disciplines, but unfortunately, environmental science is not there. Now, this India, this is also history, that India started organic standards in 2005, revised in 2014, and 2015, it started certification system, which is free of cost. I will explain you later about this PGS, participatory guarantee system. I will explain you later. For the time being, just you see that PGS is system of certification, which is free of charge, is started by Government of India in July 2015. Then EPIDA also doing some job of certification, third party certification, and they are actively involved in the regulation and promotion of organic farming in the country. And they have got one TraceNet software. It can help you to trace the history of the product, who has produced it, how many hands it has passed. So some softwares are available and developed by EPIDA. So you can trace the history of the products. And there are many TraceNet-like softwares, HortiNet, PeanutNet, TraceNet, MeatNet, and so on. So you can know the genuineness of the product. It is just to make consumer happy. And you can go through this TraceNet. What is TraceNet? Traceability is a continuous system of documentation. Please learn yourself what is TraceNet. And this is information collected under a national program for organic production. If it is for the students, those who are interested to know more about this. So this is the website. You just type EPIDA in the Google. It will take to EPIDA website. In EPIDA, you type organic products, you'll find EPIDA products on the top. In this drop-down menu, you'll find organic products. Click on that, and you will find this picture, which is before you, India Organic. So you can know the present status, means all kind of data related to official data related to organic agriculture, you can find in present status. State-wise, year-wise, place-wise, crop-wise, all kind of organic data is in present status, format of certificate for certification. Standards are there. If you want to see what are organic standard, you can see policies notification. And if you want to see inspection agencies or certification agency, you can click here. Tariffs mean the rate of certification, the money, exporter, list of exporter, importer. All sorts of information is in one place. You can know the latest information from this place. Also, national project on organic farming, it is being implemented by National Center of Organic Farming. Don't get confused. This is National Project on Organic Farming. It is implemented by National Center of Organic Farming, Ghaziabad. And this Ghaziabad Center has 9 regional stations. National Center of Organic Farming, this is also part of history. It was established in 2004. National Center of Organic Farming established in 2004. And you can see it has got some regional stations, Bangalore, Bhubaneswar, Gandhinagar, so on. So one center may look for many states. So because India is big and you cannot have a center in every state. So they have 9 centers which are catering to the need of all Indian state and union territories. And this, friends, ends, and I end it here. This Vandana Shiva, Vandana Shiva is hardcore or organic or environmentalist dealing with organic agriculture, and she published many books on organic farming, health per acre and wealth per acre. I got opportunity to inaugurate or release that book sometimes back. So this ends now. Your questions are welcome. Now you are free to interact. Your any kind of question is welcome related to today's lecture. Yeah, Shyamkaran, do you have any question on today's lecture or some related questions? Number nahi katega, chinta mat kare. Number sabko acha milega, whether you do or not, but you will get good marks. Don't worry about that. Yeah, Shyamkaran, are you there?
Sir.
Any question?